Welcome to the lecture on representation learning and autoencoder. This is a part of the advanced machine learning course that I and Professor Madhavan Mukund are offering this semester. Representing data or information at lower dimension is an important problem. Here, we are going to start with a very simple example. Suppose dataset D is x1, x2, xn, n random variables, iid, from a Poisson distribution with parameter lambda. So D contains certain information about lambda in n dimension because the dataset has n samples, n random samples. So naturally, the size of the dataset is n, so the information is on the n dimension. We cannot comprehend an information in the n dimension. So we define a statistics S bar, which is 1 by n summation xi, or simple sample mean or sample average, that we claim that x bar contains all necessary information about lambda. This is we taught you in the first semester in probability and statistics with our course. We represent the information available in n-dimensional dataset D to one-dimensional x bar. So to begin with, we had the data in n-dimensional and we compress the data, this n variables, into this x bar, which is a one-dimensional random variable. So I have now one value, gives me idea about what could be the possible value of lambda. There is a result that tells us the Fisher information that is available in the dataset D, in this dataset, and the Fisher information in the sample mean, they're exactly same, that is n by lambda. You can show this by solving this problem. This problem you can find in standard textbook on statistical inference by, say, Kasseler-Berger, linear statistical inference by C.R. Rao, all these typical book on statistical inference has these results, where I is expected value of del del theta log of fx theta whole square. This is known as the Fisher's informations. This is one way of defining information. I'm not going into the detail about what was the motivation of Fisher's information and all these things, but one can show the Fisher's information actually for the entire data set is same as Fisher's information that is available in the sample mean. So that means after compressing, so D is the n-dimensional geometric object, after compressing I brought it down to a one-dimension object and still the information is same, so that means I have not lost any information, so that I can represent the information that is available to me in n dimension. I can compress and represent it into one-dimensional field. In statistic, x bar is called sufficient statistic. Effectively, it means all information in my data set is restored in the statistic X bar. Now I will consider another example called principal component regression. Consider a simple linear regression problem, y equal to x times beta plus epsilon. Y is a n dimensional vector, x is a n cross d dimensional feature matrix, beta is the coefficient vector d cross 1, and epsilon is the error vector. So we have D many features, and suppose D is extremely large, so D, we have thousands of features. Now, PCA or principal component analysis helps us to represent this very high dimensional feature matrix into a lower dimension by multiplying the X with the U. So x is n cross d, u is a d cross p. If you multiply x, it's a linear projection, then we got a n cross p, where p is way less than d, p may be 20 or 25. So my d is maybe 1000 or 2000 or 5000, I project these d-dimensional variables into p-dimensional variables. We have to make sure the information that is being captured in the z is somewhat approximately equal to the information that is available in the x. Now, how we define x, that's a completely different story. I'm not going into that. But if you can ensure this, that information that is available in x are being also captured nicely by a lower dimensional object z, then I can redefine now my linear regression problem as y equal to z beta plus epsilon. And in this model, in this regression model, I have to estimate only p many parameters, which is much less than d. In this model, I may have to estimate thousands of parameters because if d is thousands, whereas p is maybe 15 or 20. So in this model, I have to only estimate 15 or 20 parameters. All I have to do that when I'm projecting x to a lower dimension, I'm trying to represent the x into a lower dimension, the information is restored. How we reduce dimension with principal component analysis? When we apply PCA, we have input vectors, say x in RD. D is typically very high dimension. And then we apply a simple linear transformation or linear projection of x on z by multiplying it with the u transpose, where u transpose is p cross d, and that puts the x into p dimensional space, and that's how we are trying to represent the x into z, our object in d dimension into p dimension. We can reconstruct these points as x hat equal to uz time equal to u transpose. So z is my u transpose. I just take this u transpose and plug it in here, so I get this. So the objective function typically is you take the x and you take this reconstructed points x hat and then minimize over u. Typically we have a constraint u transpose is I. At that time, it will be the minimum. So that's how we go into the dimension reduction with PCA. I'm not going into the detail about how the principal component analysis is being done. If you want to know more about it, you can look into the video lecture of Professor Madhavan. The link is given below. Let's talk about what is autoencoder. Autoencoder is typically a fit-forward network. The main objective of the autoencoder is to represent data x, which is in the d dimension, into a lower dimension, say h, which is in the p dimension. This is the main objective. Secondary objective is to if we can generate new data x from this model. This is typical visual representation of the autoencoder. So we have some input variables x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, and then we have some hidden variables or the hidden layers, and then we have some output variables. So these variables are getting reconstructed back here. Of course, each of these h has their own weights, and we take the x, the input, plug it in here, that pass through, and this gives us the output, and then we see how input and output, how far are they from, that gives us the error, and we keep trying to reduce that error, and we stop somewhere when the error is, say, minimum. That time we can say that this output is almost same as this input. If this output is almost same as the input, then these hidden layers actually contains all the information about the input x values. So we can say that we can represent these five variables with these three variables. So five-dimensional object at that time can be represented by this three-dimensional object. So that's how autoencoders typically work from, and this is just a visual representation, as I said. Now we will go into more detail about the autoencoder. General structure of the autoencoder is x is a d-dimensional object. We try to project into a lower dimensional hidden layer or hidden object, which is a d-dimensional object, and then we construct it back to same d-dimensional object. H is known as code, that is the low dimensional representation of the x, which is typically in the p dimension. So h is in the p dimension, which is a lower dimensional representation known as code. The autoencoder has the two components. One is the encoder, so this part is known as the encoder part, and this part is the decoder part. So we call it F is the encoder, which maps from X to H. This is the F part, and this G is the decoder, which maps from H to X hat. And our objective is, in the training, we will try to learn the weights in such a way so that X and X hat, the error between X and X hat will be minimum. So if you go back to the visual part, so this is our X, this is our H, and this is our X hat. So the X to X, H is the F or the encoder, and H to X hat is the G or the decoder. So this is our nutshell, is the autoencoder. The autoencoder, as we say, has two components, and standard autoencoder is sort of a deterministic model, whereas the modern autoencoders generalize the idea to a stochastic mapping and represent the encoder with a stochastic distribution, a probabilistic distribution of H given X. So given X, we try to model the H, and decoder is X given the H. So this part we try to model with another distribution, conditional distribution of X given H. So what is the goal of autoencoder? So in the learning, goal of the autoencoder is, given the input X, we want to reconstruct the X back, and during this process we want to learn the hidden layers. So the objective function would be somewhat loss function of X and G of F of X, where X equal to G of H is the decoder output and H equal to F of X is the encoder output. If there is no nonlinearity, that is no activation function, it has only single layer, then autoencoder will become sort of a PCA. So we can say, under certain regularity conditions, that PCA is a special case of autoencoder. Now, what is deep autoencoder? You can see in the regular autoencoder, you have just single layer, single hidden layer. This is the single one shallow fit forward. This is effectively a shallow fit forward network with the one layer. Whereas in the deep autoencoder, you will have several hidden layer. So that is why it's called deep autoencoder. And this is the latent space, and this part is called the encoder, and this part is called the decoder. This part is typically called code, or the encoded data represented in the lower dimensional space. So different type of autoencoder you will see. One type is typically called undercomplete, another, some of the encoder is called overcomplete. So this is an example of shallow undercomplete autoencoder. Shallow because it has only one hidden layer. It has an input variable, input vectors, and then it has the reconstructed output vector or reconstructed input vectors. Whereas this is called shallow overcomplete. You can see the number of the dimension of the hidden layer is more than the dimension of the input layer. And why we construct this kind of overcomplete autoencoder? The purpose of this autoencoder is, suppose you have only 10 features in your data set and you want to make more, engineer more features. So this is an automated way of engineering more features. This could be a, and you come up with, so you start with three vectors in your, or three variables, but you, in the process, you create the five engineered features from your data set. So that is the purpose of typically overcomplete. Similarly, you can develop a deep undercomplete autoencoder as well as a deep overcomplete autoencoder. Next, we will talk about sparse autoencoder with regularization. Sparse autoencoder is simply an autoencoder whose training criteria involves a per city penalty, omega h, on the code or the layer h. So lx g of f of x, this is typically if your input vectors are all continuous, typically we take the L2 loss function, and omega h is the penalty on the hidden layers. Typically, if you take lasso penalty or L1 penalty, that will induce a sparsity. The training will induce the sparsity, which this L1 penalty, this penalty can be equivalently like, or can be written as a Laplace Prior distribution, or the double, sometimes called double exponential Prior distribution. The such kind of autoencoder is just a fit forward networks. The same loss function output unit types can be used. A traditional fit forward network can also be used for an autoencoder. Now we will talk about something called probabilistic autoencoder. We kind of discussed it previous in few slides earlier. So the probabilistic autoencoder generalized the idea of autoencoder to stochastic mapping, where encoder F part are modeled by a conditional probability distribution of H given X. So given the input data, the hidden layer variables are follow some distribution, some probability distribution, whereas given the hidden layer variables, the decoder part of the autoencoder, given the hidden layer variables, you try to model the reconstructed inputs, the inputs variable, as a function of probability distribution. So output of a probabilistic autoencoders are partly determined by chance even after training, so it could be a little bit different. Most importantly, they are generative autoencoder. It means probabilistic autoencoder can generate a new instances that looks like they were sampled from the training dataset. Now, how we develop this kind of probabilistic autoencoder? Before we jump into understanding how we develop this kind of generative models, let us try to understand some of the concept. First, we will try to understand uncertainty quantification. We can quantify the uncertainty information of a certain event as minus log of px, where x is certain event and px is the probability of that event, and that will be between always 0 and 1. E indicates the degree of uncertainty information that is available there. And why it is called uncertainty minus log of px? Because px will be always between 0 and 1. So log of px will be always a negative number, and you multiply it with a negative 1, so it will become a positive number. Now, if px is 1, very close to 1, so that means it log of px will be very close to 0. But on the contrary, if px is very close to 0, that means log of 0 is very close to minus infinity, minus minus a positive infinity. So as px goes to 0, close to 0, e takes a very high value, e goes to infinity. On the contrary, if px goes to 1, e goes to 0. So if px is close to 1, that implies this is a very predictable scenario. Hence, not much uncertainty is there. So the uncertainty information is close to 0. Whereas if px close to 0, that means it's a very unpredictable scenario. Hence, lot of uncertainty is there and e goes to takes a very large number, e goes to infinity, near infinity. Now, if you take the average of these minus log of px with respect to the px, this is the average of the log uncertainty. On an average, what is the uncertainty? That gives us something called entropy. So entropy is the average uncertainty information. Next, we define something called Kullback-Leibler divergence, or KL divergence. KL divergence shows the dissimilarities between the two different distribution. Suppose P and Q are two different distribution. KL divergence between P and Q is defined as minus sum of px times log of qx plus sum of px log px. So if you just take the, you can write it as summation px log of qx by px. This is sort of a difference. You can see the KL divergence is sort of a difference between the entropy of Q with respect and the entropy of P, but you are taking the entropy of, computing the entropy of Q with respect to P. So that means you are computing the distance of Q with respect to P. Everything is with respect to P, the probability P distribution. So since log of QX by PX, and one can show that, you know, this is, these are the probabilities. So this will be always, and this is the divergence, this will be always greater than or equal to zero. But Kullback-Leibler divergence with respect to P and Kullback-Leibler divergence with respect to Q, they are not the same, they're not necessarily same quantity. They could be very different, they could be inequally. So that's why they are not, that means they are not symmetric. So that's why they are not distance. So Kullback, that is why it is called divergence and it's not called distance. So KL divergence is mainly gives us the idea about the dissimilarity between the two probability distributions. Now we will talk about general Bayesian inference problem. So suppose X is the observation and H is the hidden variables that we want to estimate. We would like to compute the probability of H given X. So given data, given the observation input variables, we want to make a probability model on the hidden variables. So we can write it as a P of X, comma H by P of X, whereas P of XH is the joint probability distribution of X and H. You can write this as P of X given H times P of H. Now computing P of X is very difficult because P of X is equal to integration of P of X given H times P of H dH. Evaluating this integral could be very difficult because you are doing integration over H, and if there are three variables on H, then effectively you are integrating on the three variables. So it is three, this integration is a three-dimensional integration. If this H is a five-dimensional, then it will be a five-dimensional integration. So two approaches to evaluate this integral. One is the Monte Carlo simulation. Most likely it is typically the Markov chain Monte Carlo simulation technique. Another is the variational inference. Here we will focus on the variational inference. So we want to evaluate P of H given X, which is intractable. So let's approximate P of H given X by Q of H. We want to model P of H given X, but we cannot do that because it's intractable. So we want to approximate P of H given X by Q of H. Typically Q of H is from a very known tractable family, maybe a multivariate Gaussian, a multivariate T, or some very popular distribution from where we know how to handle those kind of multivariate distributions. Choose KH in such a way such that the KL divergence of QH and the PH given X is minimum. KL divergence is minus of summation QH log of PH given X by QH. Now, since QH we know everything, so we are computing the KL divergence with respect to this QH. Let us simplify this KL divergence a little bit more. So, KL QH equal to and PH given X. So we can write it as minus sum over H QH log of PH given X by QH. The basic definition of the KL divergence. Now PH given X, we can write it as from the first principle P of XH by PX, which you can write it in this way, P of XH by PH times P of X. This you can write as log of P of XH by PH plus log of 1 by px. Now this summation is on the edge, and this part of does not involve edge, so it will behave as a constant. So it can come out of this summation. So we can write minus summation qh log of pxh by qh plus log of px. So log of px will behave as a constant. Remember that x is the observed input. So we have already observed data set. X is constant for us effectively. And if we know, even if the density of p is known, you just plug it in, you know that what is the value, log of p of x. So this simplifies to, if I take this thing on the left, this simplifies to log of px is equal to Kullback-Leibler divergence between q of h and p of h given x plus summation qh log of pxh by qh, sum is over h. Let's call this second term as L. L is known as variational lower bound. Okay. Since Kullback-Leibler divergence is always positive, this is always positive. So you can, it implies this L will be less than equal to log of px. Because p is the probability density and it's a constant, so, and this is a positive value, so it has to be naturally, if it is a positive value then, and it is a constant, then it the L has to be, you know, less than equal to log of px. Or one can say that L is the lower bound of the log of px. So now, given the observed data x, the log of px is constant. On the one hand, if this is constant and we want to minimize this Kullback-Leibler divergence, so minimizing Kullback-Leibler divergence and log px is constant is equivalent to maximizing the variational lower bound, this part. So minimizing KL divergence is same as maximizing the variational lower bound because log of px is constant. So let us see what this variational lower bound tells us. So we can write this variational lower bound as summation qh log of pxh by qh. And this joint distribution, you can write it as p x given h times p of h. Now, you can write this as a log of p x given h plus log of p h by q h. And which, in nutshell, you can write summation q h log of p x h plus summation q h log of p h q h. Now if you look at carefully, this is expected value of log px given h with respect to probability distribution qh. So that is what we are writing here, expected value of log of px given h with respect to qh. And this is Kullback-Leibler divergence between p of h and q of h and p of h minus q of h given x is the probabilistic encoder network. So we can now, so this is the variational inference, that is what we try to do in the variational inference. In the variational inference, we try to maximize the variational lower bound. Now in the variational autoencoder, what we do, we try to represent the encoder part by, we try to model, we cannot really model the pH given x, we don't know what is exactly pH given x, so we approximate the pH given x by QH given x. That is the probabilistic encoder network. It takes the x and map it to H. And if we know what is Q, what is the Gaussian distribution, if it is same, we assume it is a Gaussian distribution or something, then we know exactly how to handle, how to model this H1 and H2. Because H1, H2 may have a very different distribution, but we are approximating it with the Gaussian distribution. On the contrary, Px given H is the probabilistic decoder once we got the H1 to, you know. And when we put them together, we combine the encoder part and the decoder part, we get the autoencoder or variational autoencoder. So the variational lower bound of the autoencoder is, this is the variational lower bound of the autoencoder. The encoder pH given x, so pH given x is my encoder, which we are approximating by QH given x. Q is some known popular distribution like multivariate Gaussian distribution, etc. And if you look into the carefully, this one, this is effectively the construction error. The Px given H is effectively my likelihood function, log likelihood function, the expected log likelihood function. We are taking the expectation with respect to the QH, and this is effectively will give me the construction error. And on typically maximization problem is much more difficult problem, or any kind of optimization problem is very difficult problem. So we have to solve this maximization problem for the autoencoder, which is much more difficult problem in terms of implementation. So we will resort to existing Python implementation with TensorFlow, Keras, or scikit-learn. But this is what exactly the variational autoencoder tries to do. They tries to implement the variational autoencoder by maximizing the variational lower bound of the autoencoder. So the encoder part can be used to learn the features in lower dimension, and then you can use them as in the predictive model, and you can reduce the number of parameters. And the decoder part can be used to generate the new data, some X, sometimes it's called the fake data, which seems to have come from a training data set. And these fake data can be very useful when we do not have enough instances in the training data set. And this is very much possible to simulate, because if you look into this variational autoencoder, what we can do, that we are assuming this code part, the edge of the hidden layer, we are approximating them, the distribution of H is actually pH given X, which is a very complicated unknown distribution. We are approximating this distribution with some known distributions, a multivariate Gaussian and or multivariate T distribution. So if I know that, then what we can do, I can simulate the simulate from the Gaussian distribution, and then I can plug it in this. So if I know that H1 and H2 can be approximate by a Gaussian distribution Q, then you can simulate from this Gaussian distribution, and then you can plug it in. And if you plug it in, then it will simulate this values x1, x2, x3, x4. And this new x1, x2, x3, x4, these new values of x will be the new data, as if the new data coming from a training data set. Here is an example of generative variational autoencoder. I have taken this figure from the book titled Hands-on Machine Learning with Scikit-Learn, Keras, and TensorFlow by Aurelien Geron. It's a very nice book. You can have a look. What this figure tells us, whenever this image, which is marked by a box, these are original images from the training dataset. And the images which are not marked by boxes, these are the actually simulated data or the fake data or simulated from the variational autoencoder. So you can see there is a shoe. These two shoes are actually original shoe from the original image from the training data set. This image is a generated image. If you look into this dress, this is a generated image of a dress. This image was not there in the original data set. So in that sense, this is a fake image. Sometimes it's not doing so well. If you look into this, so it could looks like it is a bag, it's a handbag and a trouser got mixed up. So sometimes it's not simulating a good fake data, but sometimes it does, it is simulating a very good fake data or the, you know, data which is almost like a true data. So with that, I will stop here. Thank you very much.